got a funno.
See you.
on and dance, dance, dance. If you know the Lord's been good to you, if you know the Lord's been good to you, if you know the Lord's been good to you, come on and dance, dance, dance. If you know the Lord's been good to you, if you know the Lord's been good to you, if you know the Lord's been good to you, come on and dance, dance, dance. If you know the Lord's been good to you, if you know the Lord's been good to you, if you know the Lord's been good to you, come on and dance, dance, dance. Oh, 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 oh. See, the Lord is here. The Lord is here, my body. Time for Holy Ghost party. The Lord is here, my body. Time for Holy Ghost party. The Lord is here, my body. Time for Holy Ghost party. The Lord is here, my body. Time for Holy Ghost party. reality. My sin and my rejection met your blood and my acceptance.
Spirit of the Lord is there is freedom. There is no striving on the wings of our God. There is no striving on the wings of our Father. There is no striving when we rest in His heart. There is no striving. There is no driving. Ourselves in recognition. There's nowhere else to go but spin on the wings of our God. Then we go. There is no takes us if we would just remain. There's no striving in His glory. There's no trying to go any place that we would like. We just bind ourselves around His wings. Up and He lifts us up, 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 and He lifts us up. So our heads are with the head of the eagle, our eyes with the eyes of the eagle, our mouths with the cry of the eagle cries. Our heart with the heart of the eagle, our mind with the mind of the eagle flies. He takes us up. He takes us up. He takes us up. He takes us up. He takes us up.
his wings. Thank you for surrounding angels that surround the throne, that you are enthroned in our praises, and there's that witnesses and singers and elders and angels that we join the songs and melodies of the heart that join with your songs, Lord. We thank you that there's that resonance of heaven here tonight. We thank you, Lord.
Whoa. Oh.
just bless the musicians. What an amazing time. Thank you.
Bless you, Lord.
Give someone a hug on the way to their seat and just greet them. Be a bit sweaty, but that's part of our service to mankind, is to provide a bit of a workout at church as well. Glory fit, we'll call it. Glory fit. That's how you lose weight in the glory. Just let Jay lead worship and dance for half an hour. Come on.
Perfect. Thank you, Alex. And we have light. Welcome to Jubilee, especially if you're visiting for the first time. I'm going to say hi to you guys. Hope you have fun. Cheers. It's going to be the new thing now, isn't it? Cheers. Very good. Just before we take up the offering, I just want to share, I don't know whether you remember, I shared a couple of weeks ago just about my testimony of how when I first kind of got saved, and just that when I was sitting in my seat and all I had was $10, and I knew that that's all I had, you know, for the next couple of days, and just felt that prompting of the Holy Spirit saying, trust me, test me in this. And I put it in there, just going, okay, God, just stepping out and seeing that money. Literally at the end of the service, someone came up, I just really felt to give you $10. And so it was just a testimony of God's faithfulness. And, you know, I've never missed a bill because he's always, you know, met my needs. But after I shared that testimony, I had someone come up to me and say, you know, you shared that testimony, and then the Holy Spirit said to me, put in your biggest bill. And so he opened up his wallet, and he knew that he didn't have any more money for the rest of the week, didn't have the income coming in. And he said that the following, I think it was the following day or 2 days later, he opened up his wallet and there was a $50 note, and he'd put in 20, and he doesn't know where the 50 came from. So I was like, that is a very cool testimony. So I'm not saying tonight as we take up the offering that God's going to give you back. You know, if you put in 20, you're going to get 50. But what I am saying, that it's a principle that God's saying, you can trust me in this, that if you give generously and you give what's on, you know, he places on your heart, that you can trust him to come through with the rest, hey? So if the team could just take up the offering joyfully, that would be wonderful. We've got the rest of the team. Is Jared out there? Jared, are you still there? Can you do that for me? Thanks, Maz. It's just under your seat. Thanks. So just a couple of things coming up in the life of the church. Create school this Wednesday. It just gets better and better. Who's been enjoying the teaching that Izzy's outstanding? You know, we, Darren and I, do listen to a lot of podcasts out there, but I tell you what, the best messages are coming out of this house. So come along this Wednesday, Mount Zion. It's going to be fun. And then stay on for Harp and Bowl, which continues at 7:30. Fini might unpack what the cheers is all about. That, yeah, it was pretty drunken night if you missed it on Wednesday night. So the cheers came out of that glory wine swirly evening. The EP, if you haven't got a hold of Calvary yet, it's on iTunes. I believe you soon will be able to get it on CD. In 3 weeks' time, if you want to hold out and you don't want it just on iTunes, but you want it, I like the, you know, having the tangible thing in my hand. I know I'm a bit old school, but anyways, so if you want to hold off or you want both, we're going with both. We're going to go with both options. Then do that too. Cool. Now, lost property. It amazes me what we collect in this house, actually. So if you've lost anything, or if you have children that potentially have lost something, if you could go through after the service and just check out what's out there, you might be surprised what you find. It's quite a collection. Clothing, toys, all sorts of water bottles. So if you think, oh, actually, maybe I've lost something along the way, then go check it out, because it will go to Vinnie's. We might have the lost property out just one more week for those that might have been away, but do know that it will be shortly gone off to Vinnie's for a good cause. So thank you if you made a donation. Testimonies. Anyone got a testimony from this week? Healing, salvation, any testimonies? Benedict?
Hi. We're in doing the outreach in Newtown a couple of weeks ago, and Tim mentioned it, but there was a woman who had like severely impaired sight and one eye, like it was all just fuzzy and blobby and stuff, and she had like sort of close to perfect vision, like probably 90% restored after prayer. So, you know, God opens the, Jesus opens the eyes of the blind, you know, she may as well have been blind, you know, so I just figure it's just three simple little prayers and Jesus turns up with a shinding. So that's awesome. So, praise God.
Hi, I'm from Melbourne, and Melbourne's a cool place, but it's cold. I've come to visit, and on the Friday I had prayer ministry and everything for particular issues. Anyway, I haven't spoken to a lot of my friends at all over the couple of days, and two of them called, and I'm actually leaving a lifestyle that I used to live in. And two of my friends contacted me, and one wasn't very happy, but the other one just called up and said, why haven't you talked to me, blah, blah, blah. And I just felt to share with her what happened to me. And she doesn't understand fully, but I got to talk to her about my own personal journey and how I want a guy, marry a guy, and walk away from all the other stuff that I was in, and just step into what my calling is. And she didn't know what my calling was, and then I told her. And she's like, wow, it sounds like you're a real Christian then. And I'm like... And I said, I don't like being labelled, but if you want to call me that, you can. And then she's quite sick. She has chronic fatigue and really bad, actually. I've known her for a year and she's just been sick all the time. And I can't believe I've done this because I'm not even used to this myself, but like prayer ministry, right? I said, oh, you know, I know this really cool church that like they can come pray for you and you can get healed. And she's like, no way. And I'm like, yeah. So she's... And then I go, oh my God, what about if she, and then I thought, what about if she doesn't get healed? Like, but I'm like, no, she'll get healed. Because if I can get healed, she can get healed, right? So, so she's like, I'd be really interested in coming with you. So I know there's a church in Melbourne that is quite Holy Spirit-y. So I'm going to take her there. And it'll be new for me and it'll be new for her. But I thought that was really cool because I'm like coming out of something and I'm not like, I'm still working through stuff, but I thought I'd take her with me and it'll be fun.
Sarah Bell, you are amazing. We love having you here. Such a great testimony. I just want to share a quick one. I don't know if you guys remember a couple of weeks ago that I went into that prophetic, like I was just seeing the CEOs that were going to release finance. And anyway, when I got home, I said to Daryl, I actually believe, and I told him quite specifically, I said, I believe it's the mining industry, someone from mining, and it'll be out of WA. And anyway, so I got home the other night and switched on SBS News, and this mining magnate from WA gets up and he'd made this, I think it was 60-something million dollar donation back into education. And he He is now testifying and saying to everyone who's, you know, like businessmen and all the rest of it, saying you must consider sowing back into the community. And I thought that was a cool testimony of God. How good is he? He's distributing the wealth throughout the nation where it's really needed. And I love that. I don't know whether this man's a Christian or not, but I just love that he was saying to all of those, you know, we need to really sow back in. So I just wanted to say as an encouragement that the things that we're praying into, the things we are seeing, are going to manifest. Absolutely. So it's just an encouragement to keep on praying and keep on speaking out and decreeing those things that you're seeing, because they're really important and powerful. Fini.
Come on. I'm not preaching tonight. I'm going to introduce the speaker in a minute. But I wanted to share just something with you, because those of you who weren't, who of you are from Jubilee but weren't here this morning? Put up your hands. All right, this is for you. And you only, all right? So you hold on to this. What I ministered this morning was just that we have a great culture in this church. We have a great culture of worship, a great Holy Spirit culture. We have a culture of love. We have a culture of fellowship and small groups and kids ministry and women's ministry and healing rooms. There are many things over the years that God has given us that we're very, very delighted in and proud of and think that we're great. And, you know, we celebrate those things about Jubilee. But something that's crept up on us over the last few years has been that we've also developed a very high commitment to being late. And starting late, and rocking up at a home group half an hour late, and church could be half an hour, 45 minutes. And I realized that as in terms of excellence, in terms of honor, it doesn't match. Honor looks like something. Honor looks like, you know, if I'm going to see you for coffee at 5:15, it's not 5:30, it's 5:15. Because that's me saying to you, I honor your time more than me. I want to honor your time. If I come late, what I'm saying is that my time is more important than you. You're not that important. I'm a very important person, and you'll just wait for me to come and have to accept my lame apologies. And what it really is laziness and a poor planning. And if we call it what it is, and lack of honor, and just say, whoa, we can repent of that. We don't have to take 6 weeks to change a bad habit. We can just change it in 1 week. And next Sunday, we're going to start the service at 6. I know, it's extraordinary. It's a sign and a wonder. It's a sign and a wonder, but we advertise 6, and what it actually is 6-ish, and I think we need to leave the ish off and just make it 6. We're going to start at 6 in the morning. We're going to start at 10 o'clock exactly, not 5 past 10. We'll start at 10, and so what I'm encouraging you to do, those of you that are Jubilee members, come early. Don't come on time. On time is really 2012. It's old. It's like on time. I'm actually a person who likes to just get there on time, mostly. In church, I'm very early because I'm normally involved in worship and stuff. But I normally just want to get there on time. I allow myself. But I want us to shift the culture in the church and be early. If you want to fellowship, hang out with people, say, oh, let's meet early. Let's get together for a coffee before church. You can also hang out afterwards and go for Mexican and pizza and all the other things, Vietnamese you go for. That's awesome. But let's not dishonor God by being late consistently. And just repent and say, repent is not saying sorry. Repentance is just not doing it again. So I repented. Well, why are you still doing it then, you know? Repentance looks like something and honor looks like something. So we're going to honor God. We're going to honor the people that have come early because all the visitors are on time. You notice that? You see the visitors, all strangers looking around the church like lost. What's going on? Where is everybody? You can pick them because they're on time. And so we're just going to come before the visitors, and when the visitors come and say, hi, you must be new. And we can just welcome them and say, hey, do you have kids? Do you know, where the bathrooms are? Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. This is the worship leader. His name's Jay. He's amazing. Da-da-da-da-da-da. Come on. And so we become the hosts. We host people, not just the Holy Spirit. We host people and make them feel welcome. And that is, it only happens through intentionality. It happens through preparing well to leave on time, so you can get there on time and allow for traffic, allow for the fact that there's no parking in the eastern suburbs. We know that. You know, when you go to a restaurant, you think, oh, there's no parking, I'm going to the city. Well, you just go a bit earlier because you know you're going to have to look and run, do round and round and round, look for parking and park a mile away and walk. That's the awesomeness of being in Jubilee and being in the eastern suburbs. There's no parking. And it's just one of those, one of the blessings that we have, the challenge. You know, all church growth things, you've got to have parking, you've got to have more parking than what you need, you've got to have this. We haven't got any of those things. And the church keeps growing and people keep getting saved and people, God keeps turning up. Amen. In spite of all those things. So I want to ask you just to join with me, those of you that are Jubilee members, and say, Fini, we can do this. We can do this. We repent and we change and we honor God. We honor visitors. We honor the elders. We honor Fini. He's a good guy. Amen. And now it's my absolute pleasure to welcome someone who is a son in our house, although he doesn't live in Sydney, he lives in Newcastle. Someone's going to live in Newcastle. But we got to know Mick. Those of you who haven't met Mick, most of us do know him, but those of you who don't know him, he came to Jubilee about 4 years ago and just got wrecked. First night, smashed, right here on the carpet. The next night, next Sunday, same thing. God just healing, years of legalism, years of disappointment, years of stuff that he'd heard, that he'd given up on, dreams he had seen just fall to the ground. And then one day, people started joining him and coming down from Newcastle, and all these people came and drove every Sunday down to Jubilee from Newcastle. It was such fun. And one day they started a home group. It grew from 4 to 40 in 4 weeks. I'm not exaggerating, because I went up there. There were 70 actually the night I went up. But with Izzy, but it was just one of those amazing moves of God that we knew it wasn't just a home group, this was going to become a church. And I think 2 years ago, they started Grace River, and it's a thriving community of believers that have a very similar DNA. They're independent church, they're autonomous, they have their own governance, and they have their own, you know, their structure, but they're family to us. They really are family. And so we welcome you, Mick. You give it to us. We love what you have. Go for it.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I just want to share just really quickly a vision that I was taken into during the worship tonight, and this is going to apply to a lot of people here. And I was sitting on the back of like this huge bird, huge eagle, and instead of sort of going this way, it was kind of going that way. So it was kind of a steep acceleration, and I kept on getting the words acceleration and elevation. And what I kept on hearing the Spirit say was, this was for every area of your life. Acceleration and elevation, every area of your life. And I heard the words spiritual D-Day. And the D stands for destiny. Because what's happened over the years is many people have come under different things that has tried to kind of get them away from their destiny in Christ. But I felt that the Lord was just announcing in the Spirit that there is a spiritual D-Day, a spiritual destiny day for you. And a lot of you, the Lord has walked you through a season. He's taken you by the hand and walked you through a season. I just feel that there is a, just as that bird was flying through layers of cloud, and then right at the end, it just kind of burst through into brilliant sunshine and just kind of leveled out. And it was high and just over everything. You could just, clear blue sky, the clouds were below, and it was just sort of sailing along. And I feel that that is like where a lot of you are actually on the journey towards right now. Like God has got you by the hand. He's walked you through those seasons. It's almost like you've flown through the cloud cover at different heights and different stages. And now the breakthrough is like right there. It's like the last lot of cloud cover. It's your spiritual destiny day. You're about to just cross over. These were the other words I was getting as well. There was a coming out, a crossing over, and a going up. See, we never just come out of something to just stay there. We come out of something to go to a new place. And we come out from something to go higher. And I feel that's for a lot of you guys in here today. I just got that word really clearly as I was getting the vision through worship. So if that spoke to you, just raise your hands right now just to activate that. Holy Spirit, I thank you for what you are breathing and what you are releasing in this place tonight, God. Ha! Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, that you have taken us by the hand, Lord. That, God, you have pronounced over us a spiritual D-Day. Lord, where we are about to break through the last layer, God, where there is an acceleration and an elevation coming to every single area of our life, God. And we thank you for that tonight, Father. Lord, we partner with you in that, Holy Spirit. And we just say yes and amen and yes and amen, Lord. We just align ourselves with that in faith. Really simply just align ourselves in faith with that, God, because it's you that's doing it, Lord. We're just along for the journey, Lord. We get the privilege and the pleasure of just being in your arms, Lord, as you do this, as you unfold this and work this out through us, God. So we receive it, Lord. We receive it and we just give ourselves wholeheartedly again to you, God. Lord, any area of our life where we have held back from you because we really haven't realized just how good you are and how much you love us, God, and how much your favor is over us and how much your spirit burns in us. Father, every area right now, we ask that right now the refiner's fire would just come, Lord, and just be released in us, God. That the fire of your love, Lord, would just get on those areas, God. Things that we have partnered with, any areas of unbelief, God, that just even right now, Holy Spirit, you are just turning those things into ashes. That the gold is coming to the surface. The gold is rising. The gold is rising. The gold is shining. So we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Everybody said, amen. Wow. I want to start off with a couple of quotes here from some very famous people. One's by a name called A.B. Simpson. Listen to this. This is kind of, yeah, if you like, man, that's brilliant. Absolutely. Just keep playing, dude. That's really good. That's really good. So he takes us into the divine family. He makes us partakers of the divine nature. He undertakes our life for us. He becomes the author and the finisher of our faith. And he works in us to will and to do for his good pleasure. This is incomprehensible to our finite minds. And the great John G. Lake, man, I love this. He says this. He said, Christ lives in me. That is the revelation of this age. That is the discovery of the moment. That is the revolutionizing power of God in the earth. It's the factor that is changing the spirit of religion in the world and the character of Christian faith. It is divine revitalization. You know, for too long, we've kind of lived with this theology and a mentality that has said that we are separate from God. And so what we've tried to do all the time is we've tried to go to the high place, but we have to realize that God came down from the high place to us. He's already done it at the cross, amen. He came down out of glory. The man and the king of glory came down out of the place of glory and met with us right where we were at. And the amazing thing about being a born-again believer is that the Apostle Paul actually said this about every single one of us, that we are now have been made competent ministers of the new covenant. And that thing about that spiritual D-Day, I really got a sense that was sort of continuing on from that word that Brian Simmons released over Australia about the war on theology. There was coming like a theological war. I just see as the fire of God gets on the people of God, He's refining our hearts and refining the way that we think in terms of where are we actually seated now? Do we still have one leg in the old covenant and one leg in the new covenant? Are we kind of straddling the fence? Let me tell you what happens when you straddle a fence. There's going to come pain. I'm a country boy. I've straddled fences all my life. I know pain. And this is what's going to happen. We're going to actually see this stuff come to the surface in the body of Christ. And you know what? It's a good thing. We need to embrace what's happening. We really need to embrace it. We've got to go with it. So we've already been declared as ministers of the new covenant. And listening to what Joe McIntyre says, he says, ministry becomes our allowing him to express his dominion through us and destroy the works of darkness by our words and deeds. Now see, when we first kicked off Grace River, we were on a Thursday night and we just had these insane glory meetings where most of the time we didn't even preach. Myself and another guy, we grabbed our guitars, we got up the front and we just went into prophetic worship straight away. And people were just getting laid out under the power of the Spirit everywhere, manifesting all sorts of things. It was great. I loved it. And then we changed for Saturday night, which was awesome. And we found that we had so many different types of people there. So many people they came out of all different sorts of theological and religious backgrounds and all this other kind of stuff. And that was interesting. When you're up there just giving the purity of the gospel, that Jesus actually really did die for all of your sin. Not just the ones you committed and repented of yesterday, but the ones to come. There was a real war going on in the realm of the Spirit in those meetings because so many different people had come in carrying a whole lot of stuff. And so it was awesome to actually wade through that. Like if you want to grow as a believer or in ministry, start confronting where people are at as far as, do you realize you're in the new covenant now? You're a born-again, new covenant believer. You're actually a son now. That you don't that orphan kind of mentality doesn't fit you anymore. It's like pulling on the coat and the sleeves kind of come up to there. It's like, yeah. That's not who we are anymore. We're sons of glory. And so Jesus has commissioned every single one of us, when we got born again, to actually go into all the world and to preach the gospel. Amen? It's a really simple message tonight, but the power of God always gets released in these kind of things. And that's what we want, amen? We never want to sit under sermons and ministries that has no substance to it. Because in Hebrews 11, it says that, you know, it talks about faith. There is a substance to it. There is a reality to it. And there is a reality to the word, and there is a reality to your life that is so much higher than where we've been living in the past. There is a substance to what we've been believing, but there is a greater substance. There is something else that's even bigger than where we've been at. Amen? So Ephesians, let me just go over. Okay. So we had some really interesting times about how we were sort of navigating people through their theology and where they were at. And one day the Lord just spoke to me and said, you know, I haven't called you to go and argue with these people. I've just called you to be yourself and preach the message I've put in your heart. And so we found that when we did that, we started to discover, okay, here's the guys here that have really taken hold of this message. They're in, boots and all. They've got amazing revelation of the gospel. They encounter Christ regularly. They're there. They're set. And so on the other hand, then we had a whole other group of people who were still trying to live by the Ten Commandments. That's tough. That's real tough. You go to some people's houses and they'll have the Ten Commandments up on the wall, and you know the law was beautiful when it was brought out. It just really had no power to get us right with God. It kind of highlighted all the little things that were wrong in your life. And the amazing thing is, because of where we've come out of, people are still trying to live by the law. And the law was actually given to increase the knowledge of sin. So people are actually taking out a gun and shooting themselves in both feet because they're trying to live by something and get themselves right with God when it was actually designed to expose all their faults and their shortcomings. that kind of sounds like insanity to me. And so this is what's happened. So, and the Lord just kept on speaking to me and saying, you know, I just want you to love them. Just love them through it. That's all you got to do. Just love them through it. And I like doing that with people. I'm a lover of people. I'm, yes, Jesus, I'm all the way into this. So we just love people through it. And what happens was, when we found that we loved people through their theology, what happens was they were opened up to a whole new paradigm shift. Why? Because they saw substance. There was a substance to what we were saying to them and how we were presenting the gospel. And the substance started to manifest itself in signs and wonders and miracles and all sorts of stuff. Like a couple of weeks ago, I think I was preaching, just doing some activations in the angelic realm. And then the following Sunday morning, one of the young ladies in the church came up to me and just said, oh, after you preached that message last Sunday night, I just need to tell you that for three consecutive mornings in a row, I was waking up. And the very first morning I woke up, and I had like glittery kind of stuff all over the palms of my hands. And she's like looking around her room, wondering if there was something that she'd touched. And it's like, well, no, there's no glitter in here. Didn't give it too much thought. The next morning she wakes up and there's more. And then the third morning she wakes up and her hands are completely covered in this beautiful, beautiful golden dust all over her hands. It was in a bed, all sorts of stuff. And she was one of those people who had been in other churches before and had been under other teachings and theologies and all that kind of stuff that had almost caused a ceiling, like a lid, to come over her life. And since her and her family have been coming to Grace River, it's like the lid's off. They're like, the cat's out of the bag now. There's no going back. Because once you get a hold of Christ and Him crucified, there is no going back. And when Fini shared that little testimony about where I'd come from, that was exactly what it was like for me that first night when I came here and just got wrecked. I came down the front and Fini just walked straight over to me and did the intros, and we had a quick chat for a while, and he said, can I pray for you? I'm like, yeah, absolutely. So I just stood there and he just prayed for me, man. I'm telling you, the power of God just bang, wiped me out on the floor. And Finn just come and knelt down beside me and put his hands on my chest. And we just stayed there. Just prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. And God was just like releasing things off my life. Like, I mean, instantaneously there were things that were just getting broken off. It was amazing. And then fast forward to the first night that he comes up the Grace River. He says, do you remember the first night you came to Jubilee? And I'm like, how could I forget that? That was intense. He said to me, when you walked down the front, he said, the Lord actually said to me, that man over there, I want you to pray for him because I'm setting him apart for the ministry. That was the first night I came here. I wasn't hearing that from the Lord. I was hearing a whole lot of pain and a whole lot of brokenness. That's what I was hearing. But God arrested me that night in a major way. And now he's just unfolded his whole plan. So I want to go quickly to Ephesians. God is good. Amen. He is awesome. So Ephesians 1, verse 17 to 19 says this, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you will know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might. Now, you can go to seminary / Bible school / whatever for the next 30 years, but if you don't receive a spirit of wisdom and revelation, you're going to come out with a whole lot of knowledge and not a lot of substance. And I'm not dissing those kind of things. I actually really believe that we're actually going to see, I believe, planted ministries coming up. Bible schools are just going to start to pop up in different locations that are going to be so fueled by the Spirit, absolutely fueled by the Spirit, where it's like there'll be no kind of walking in and just going, okay, well, I'm just here to learn about, you know, the book of Galatians. No, it'll be an experience of the book of Galatians. It'll be an experience of the book of Ephesians. It'll be an experience of Revelation. That's what I want. And so I've actually undertaken some study just really recently, a supernatural school online, and you know, I'm tracking along with everything that they're teaching because I've been right there. But the great thing about it is, at the same time, it's like there is so much of the Spirit on it, and I'm right into it, and I love it. And I've sort of been sharing some stuff with the guys up in Newcastle, and we've been seeing amazing things happen. There's always substance. So we need the revelation of Christ Himself. And here's the thing about truth. Truth can either stay intellectual or it become experiential. And Jesus obviously is truth. And He was an experience. He came out of heaven as a man and walked around with these rough guys. The Word became flesh and manifested itself among us, showed Himself among us. Amen. There was a substance to the Word. And this is where I believe that this season that God is bringing the body corporately into, but especially for people here, is that there is going to be a release of experience of the Word like never before. It's the whole thing I saw about the acceleration and the elevation. It's not just going to be knowledge for the sake of knowledge anymore, just so you can argue with the Mormons when they come knocking on your door. Because we actually weren't even called to argue with the Mormons or the J-dubs. The thing I love about the Apostle Paul is that he came out of a very religious background, very legalistic. And you could look back through his life and see all the accomplishments that he made in Judaism. I mean, if he would have been, you know, if he would have stepped into our time frame now, he would have been like the professor of the local seminary or wherever. He was right up there. But then he actually goes on and says, which I really love, he's like, you know, everything that I actually gained through everything that I learned my whole life that I've just walked through, I'm wondering what the point of it was now. Because all I want to know is Christ and Him crucified. So, getting into my message tonight. Colossians 1:27 says that it's Christ in me, the hope of glory. And so when we got saved, we actually came to that place of meeting the Savior face to face. We actually saw what He did for us on the cross. We put our faith in Him and we got born again. And as amazing as all that is that He did for us, I believe that that is the doorway for the rest of the journey. That's the doorway that we go into, because now He's been alive for over 2,000 years. And so in a way, we're kind of having to go back to the future so we can go back to the past. It's like we still need to see Christ there, but we have to know exactly what He's done after the fact of the resurrection. What's He doing now? And the Bible says that we have now actually been taken and put in Him. We have been seated with Christ in the heavenly realm. See, a lot of people are trying to get to a heavenly perspective, but you've got to realize that you're already there. That's where you're seated right now in Christ. It's like you have one foot on the natural plane, and your other foot is in the realm of the Spirit. I mean, we are the original cloud walkers, if you want to put it in that kind of context. We are the original cloud walkers. We straddle two different realms simultaneously, and we have a sphere of influence and an authority to operate in both of those realms simultaneously. And so the more that the Holy Spirit has just been unpacking this kind of truth, the more stuff has been happening. I'll turn over really quickly to Galatians 1, verse 15, 16. It's Paul saying to the Galatians, he's saying, "But when God, who had set me apart even from my mother's womb and called me through His grace, was pleased to reveal His Son in me so that I might preach Him among the Gentiles." If you've ever wondering what God's will for your life is, it's that you would actually reveal the Son to the world around you. That's what the plan of God is for your life. You're going from glory to glory to glory. Elevation and acceleration. The sun is being revealed in your life on a daily basis as much as you are yielded to the Holy Spirit. And that's His great plan for you. So we actually need the Holy Spirit to enlarge our vision of what it means to have Christ enthroned on the inside of us. He is the King of glory, amen? And He lives in us now. Our hope of glory in this life is Christ in us. Christ in all His fullness and dominion revealed in us. And this reality can bring the church to a whole new level of fruitfulness. Can you imagine if congregations all over the world just sat down for a minute and just stopped doing what they were doing and just realized, Jesus, You're in me. Wow, You're in me, Jesus. And that's true for every single one of you here. You can actually sit there right now and put your hand over your heart and say, Jesus, You are in me. You are being revealed in me. See, that is the hope of glory. That is the hope of glory right there. Listen to Psalm 24, verse 7 to 9. This is amazing. This is out of the Passion Translation. This is incredible. He says, so wake up, you living gateways. Lift up your heads, you ageless doors of destiny. Welcome the glory King who is about to come through you. You ask, who is this King of glory? It is the Lord, armed and ready for battle, the mighty one, invincible in every way. So wake up, you living gateways, and rejoice. Fling wide open, you forever doors of destiny. Here He comes. The glory King is ready to come in. Now listen, all of that was true of you the day that you got born again. You flung wide the doors of your heart and the glory King came in. But guess what? He wants now to come out. He wants to manifest Himself in your life so that He comes out into the world around you. This is not about four walls anymore. It's never, ever, ever been about four walls. Somewhere along the track, we made it about four walls. But it's never been about the four walls. It's been about heavenly gates being opened so the King of glory can come in and out and in and out. So we invited Him by faith. And here's the amazing thing about that. The Holy Spirit just wants to journey with us and to give us like a progressive experiential revelation of His enthroning in our hearts. We never stop. We never ever stop. Glory to glory is the mandate that heaven has for your life. If you think you've hit a good spot now, guess what? It's going to get better. And if you're at a really bad place right now, guess what? It's going to get better. So somewhere along the line, it's going to get better. See, on every journey, there are twists and turns, and there are little details that you can take here, there, and everywhere. And I've taken, God knows I've taken a fair few in my life. I got saved in 1996, and for chunks of that period, I just walked away from church. I'm over it. See you later. But it'd be amazing. I'd be laying in bed of a nighttime, and the fire of God would be like burning in my chest. I wasn't fellowshipping with believers, man. I was back out playing in bands and doing whatever. And yet I'd lay there at night and His Spirit would just be all over me. And I'd be like, one day, God, I'll come back to You. One day I'll come back to You and serve You, God. But here's the thing. I failed to realize that I'd never left Him and He'd never left me. Because wherever I go, He is, and wherever He goes, I am. I was just shutting my mind off to the reality of Him. I was stopping up my ears to the reality of Him. Because when He speaks to you, man, you can't get away from that voice. You just can't get away from the voice. Let me just go into something really quickly here. Galatians 4:19. This is specifically for leaders. My little children, for whom I labor in birth again until Christ is formed in you. This is Paul speaking to the Galatians. Now, he's had to come along and bring correction because they've tried to fall back in love with the glamour of the Pharisaical way of life. I mean, these guys wore the best robes. they had the best seats in the synagogues and the feasts and the temple, and they were like the elite. They had all the best things happening for them. People were blessing them with money, and it was all this kind of stuff. And then Paul actually had to rebuke the Galatians. He said, hey guys, what are you doing? You're trying to fall back in love with something that's passed away. You've actually been seduced by the spirit of religion. And he just came in love and he said, let me bring some correction to you. Let me start to tell you who you are. And for a lot of years, I was under that same kind of thing in churches. When people would try to bring correction into your life, it wasn't done in a spirit of love. It wasn't done in a spirit of grace. It was like old covenant, Old Testament, do this and you're a dead man. Basically. But Paul just came in love and he says, hey guys, you've seen Christ. You've heard the testimony of him. He is the way to go. He's already fulfilled what you guys are trying to live up to. So just forget it and keep your eyes on him. That's all. He actually wants to be enthroned in your heart. Not the glamour of the old Pharisaical way of life. His glory wants to be enthroned in your heart solidly. So for leaders, this is exactly what's happening, I believe, in the church today, that there are leaders rising up now who are going to be bold. Really, really bold in love. And they'll stand and they'll actually, yeah, look, I hear what you're saying to me. I understand where you're coming from, but... but... this is where it's at. It's Christ and him crucified. And it's you now living the resurrection life. That's where it is. Shabba. So he brings a correction. And this is what we need to do today as leaders as well. And you could be leading in any kind of sphere of influence. You don't have to be up here preaching the word. Because you're all ministers of the new covenant. That's the whole thing. Every single one of you here has been given a ministry. You've been given a sphere of influence. And God actually wants to release you into that sphere of influence in a greater, greater way. Let me flick over to Ephesians again. It's one of my favorite books of the Bible. Ephesians chapter 3. And as much as I love prayer, there are some certain things that I'm deciding to pray over my life. And this is one of them. Ephesians 3, verse 16 down to 21 says this, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his spirit in the inner man. So that Christ, nothing else but Christ, may dwell in your hearts through faith. And that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. Being filled up to all the fullness of God has a qualification on it. And the qualification is this, that the Holy Spirit reveals it to you so that you know it and then you can experience it for yourself. That's the qualification right there. If you're trying to get that by any other means, apart from the Holy Spirit and his revelation, you probably just need to take a couple of steps back, sit down, chill out, and let the Holy Spirit get on you. That's what you need to do. Amen? So that word there, power, for all the scholars out there who know the Greek and everything else, it's dunamis, and there's a couple of really interesting things about that word. It means strength, power, ability, but here's another really good one. Inherent power, a power residing in a thing by virtue of its nature, or which a person or thing overts and puts forth. It's also power for performing miracles. It's for moral power and excellence of soul. It's the power and influence which belong to riches and wealth, and power and resources arising from numbers. It's power consisting in or resting upon armies, forces, and hosts. That's a whole lot of power. And that's the very thing that the Holy Spirit wants to strengthen you with in the inner man. That kind of power. My question would be, is when was the last time you actually just sat and just allowed the Holy Spirit to do that? where you actually just flung open the gates and just said, Lord, I want to experience the power. I just want to experience the power. Because that's your birthright. It's inherent in you because of your nature, because you have a brand new nature now and a new heart. As a born-again believer, this is already in you. Can you see how we've kind of moved away from the simplicity of this and the power of this gospel, where we've been sort of caught up over the centuries of just trying to do enough and trying to be enough, when God already says, you already are, because I've made you that way. I've declared it over your life. All I want you to do now is just align yourself with my truth. That's simple stuff. See, God doesn't complicate things. Here's a really good way to tell if the enemy or God's at work in your life. John 10:10 says that the enemy or the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus says, I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly. That's pretty black and white. If you're being stolen from, if there is destruction coming, and you feel like you're being killed, that ain't God. It's really simple stuff. There's no need to complicate this. So when the Holy Spirit actually puts a finger on one part of your life that you are experiencing death in, or destruction, or you've been stolen from, he's not doing it to point it out, going, look at you. Call yourself a... No, no, no. He's just going, I would love to get all over that. I have something here amazing that will blow your mind. Let me in there. Just let me in it. Let me on it. That's why he's called the Comforter. Really simple stuff. Amen? So what we need to be doing is living in a progressive revelation of the truth of the word. You know, when Jesus talked about the parable of the sower, how there's different seeds fall on different soils. You know, I used to get really kind of anxious and strung out about, like, what sort of soil have I got in my heart, God? Is it stony? Is it rocky? Is it full of weeds? Until one day recently, the Holy Spirit said to me, are you born again? Yes, absolutely. Then I've given you a new heart and you've got good soil. The seed has already been sown. I already reaped a harvest, thank you. I already reaped a 30-fold harvest because I believed in the word. The word took root in my heart, and now what's happening? There is now 60-fold and 100-fold coming. It wasn't because I spent all day, every day in this. I can't. I don't have the time. I've got to go to work and stuff. But when you just take hold of truth and ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, I want to know what this means. Will you show me what this means? He loves those type of prayers. He's all over them. 30, 60, 100-fold progressive experiential revelation. The substance. That's what it's about. It's about the substance. Amen? Let me finish on this. Philippians 1 verse 6 says this, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. That's a good truth right there. Obviously, there are things that the Holy Spirit will get us to partner with him to do, but the doing is not in a getting way. The doing for us as New Covenant believers is a releasing. When Jesus first appeared on the earth, he walked around saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And what was he saying to people? He wasn't telling people to get on the ground and on their face and cry all day and, you know, try to confess everything in case they went to hell if they died that night. He was saying, no, you need to change the way that you think, because heaven is right here with you. It's looking you in the face, and it's me. And then when he went a step further then and said, I'm actually going to come and live inside of you. I'm going to put heaven the atmosphere that I carry, I'm going to place that right in the middle of you. So each one of you now, whether you realize it or not, have the atmosphere of heaven already on the inside. And the point to our life these days now is not so much in trying to get something, it's releasing what God has put in us. That's the thing, it's releasing. Christianity was never meant to be just a bless me club. I love getting blessed. I get blessed all the time with different things. I love it. But we're blessed to be a blessing. We got the greatest blessing we could ever get, and that was Jesus. Amen? Like, he came out of that place and went in there. You need to go home and look in the mirror and just say, Jesus lives in there. That's all you need to do. You need to practice that. Just practice his presence. Really simple stuff. Just practice looking at there and just going, Jesus lives in there. And when you get the revelation, your life will change radically, I'm telling you. Progressive revelation. Progressive experiential revelation. That's what we're about. So when he talks there about completing it until the day of Jesus Christ, there's a couple of things there that really popped out to me that I just found. I saw that as a twofold thing. You could either take it one way as, okay, when we actually leave this earth and go home to be with Christ. But I would venture to say it's more along this second one. It's Christ revealing in your maturity. Maturity doesn't mean that you've been in church for 50 years. Because I've seen people in church for 50 years who will get offended at the drop of a hat. And I've seen brand new born-again believers walk into a building, have an incredible encounter in the Spirit, and go out and just start laying their hands on the sick and they're being healed. The maturity comes in what we carry and what we release. That's real spiritual maturity right there, is knowing that, you know what, I am stepping fully into the new covenant as opposed from kind of having one foot in there and one foot over here. That's maturity. And that's going to be one of the things that you will see unfolding in the church. Immaturity versus maturity. Are you still living under here, or have you come into the freedom of this? That's what it's about. So, why don't you just lift your hands up? I just really feel to. It's still an activation, huh? They're always fun. They're always fun. Father, I thank you that your word is so true. And I thank you that there is substance, that there is a realm to your word. That your word, Lord, carries its own atmosphere. It carries its own inherent power. It carries the very atmosphere of heaven with your word, Lord. And Father, so just as Paul prayed over the early churches, Father, I just pray right now for every single person here, that they would be given right now, Lord, a spirit of wisdom and of revelation. That, Lord, they would know the height, the length, the width, and the depth of your love that passes all understanding, God. Lord, that we would know the power that is at work in us, the power that is toward us, because it's your power, Father. The very same spirit that hovered over creation is the very same spirit that raised Christ from the dead, and the word tells us now is the very same spirit that dwells in us bodily. Substance. A person came on the inside of you and made his home there. The Spirit of God. The sevenfold spirit. Spirit of wisdom and revelation. A spirit of might. And he wants to reveal himself through us. So right now, God, we throw open and fling wide open the forever doors of destiny in our hearts, God. So that, God, not only would you come in, but you would have an avenue to go back out again. Because, Lord, we want to impact the world around us, God. We want to impact our families, Lord. We want to impact our workplaces, God. So, Holy Spirit, would you just have your way in us right now. We open the doors to you, Lord. Not so much that you can come in, but you can get out. The free-flowing river can be released, God. The molten river of the fire of the love of God can begin to free flow everywhere we step foot, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, we would experience everything of that realm of where we are seated with you right now, Lord. And I pray an increase right now over every person's life here. I just pray an increase of just of angelic activity right now. That ministers of fire, the ones who have been sent to the, minister to the heirs of salvation, that's us. That they would come right now. We welcome them. We welcome the ministers of fire. We welcome you, ministers of fire. We welcome you. We welcome you. We welcome you. We welcome the assignments that you have been sent to release to us, so that we can then take those assignments and release them to the world around us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, that we would begin to experience in a greater way the realm of where we are seated with you, Jesus, in you at the right hand of the majesty of heaven. Because, Lord, your word says that we are living, breathing, walking, talking temples of God, knitted together into a spiritual body. So, Father, I thank you for the reality of that, God. That there would just come a greater awareness, Lord, a greater activation of that in our heart and in our life, Lord. Lord, that we would even just walk into a room and we would shift the atmosphere to one of glory, where people's hearts are open and they're like, I need to know this Jesus. I just need to know this Jesus. Thank you, Lord. 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 More, God. More. More. See, as the word is preached, substance takes shape. The Holy Spirit in the angelic realm start to shape things. Reshaping. Getting back into its proper shape. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, that even right now your hands are on the inside of us, God, molding us into the shape that you have desired for us, Lord. You're shaping us to look just like Jesus. Because, Lord, this whole earth is groaning as in labor pains, and it's waiting for the sons of God to be revealed. So, Lord, we thank you for the refiner's fire. We thank you. When we receive the refiner's fire right now, Lord, that as the fire comes, Lord, there is a revealing through the fire. There's a revealing of our sonship through the fire. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father.
Lord, any area that doesn't know the touch of your fire, we throw it open to you right now, Holy Spirit. And we say, Lord, set those areas ablaze. Even right now, Lord, right now, right now. Father, where there has been areas of dead wood in our lives, areas of thinking, things we do or say, Lord, wherever there's dead wood and a match hits it, as we've been seeing in the natural, then Father, let it be even greater in the realm of the Spirit right now. Let it be even greater right now, Holy Spirit. Let it be even greater right now, Lord, that the flames of your love, God, would begin to get on those areas, Lord, where it's been dead wood backed up and logged up with things that have tried to hold us back, God. That the fire of God would just burn so bright on those things right now, Holy Spirit. You would set those areas ablaze, God, so that through the fire, Lord, there will be a revealing of who we are in you, Jesus, and of who you are in us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You are constantly revealing us through fire, Lord, through the fire of your love. Thank you, Father. Fiery love. Revealed through fiery love. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Fire, fall down. Let your fire fall down on us, we pray. Fire, fall down. Fire, fall down on us, we pray. Let your fire fall down. Fire, fall down on us, we pray. Let your fire fall down. Fire, fall down on us, we pray. Let your fire fall down. Fire, fall down on us, we pray. Let your fire fall down. Fire, fall down on us, we pray. Let your fire come, Lord. Let your fire come, Holy Spirit. Lord, let it burn us from the inside out, Lord. From the inside out, Lord. Let it burn us from the inside out, God. Consumed with your passion, Lord. Consumed in your glory. Consumed in your power. Consumed in your might, Holy Spirit. Ha. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Burn us from the inside out, God. Burn us from the inside out, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. 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 I had an amazing vision in church this morning, and I'm seeing the same thing again right now. I'm just seeing like people's bodies being clothed in fire. Right now, just swirly flames of fire just going all around them. And here's the thing about the fire on your life. When Pentecost came, there was a flame above every single person's head. Now, the person who had the fire on them couldn't see that fire, but everybody else around them could. And this is why God forms glory communities, so that we can see your fire and you can see ours, and we start to partake of each other's fire. That's what glory kingdom communities are about, partaking of each other's fire. Listen, I just want to open up the front. There is such an atmosphere. I mean, it's all the way to the back. All the way to the back. But if you want to come and just lay or sit or kneel or whatever and just let the fire of God, just let the holy fire, the love fire of the Holy Spirit, when you fling open the forever doors of destiny in your heart, and you're actually just inviting Him. You're rolling out the red carpet and saying, Holy Spirit, have your way. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Have your way, Holy Spirit. Let your fire burn bright in me, brighter than ever before, Lord.
On us we pray. Come set a fire in us, we pray. Come set a fire. Come set a fire in us, we pray. Come set a fire. Come set a fire in us, we pray. Come set a fire. Come set a fire in us, we pray. I want.
take to school, it's fine. But we'll keep soaking. If you need ministry, ask the Holy Spirit to minister to you. I don't think the team will be able to reach you tonight. There's just too many people up front. But let's just bless Mick. It was an amazing ministry, an amazing preacher. Newcastle's blessed to have him, and we're blessed to have him as a son. Amen. So just keep, you guys can keep playing for it just a little longer, not too loud, just keep it at that level. That's great.